Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. We have a power-packed show today, starting, of course, with the latest on health and healing. We're going to look at the science confirming that you should stop and smell the roses. Even short nature interventions can bring out the best in people. Then today is commentary day. I've written many commentaries over the last week. I'll be sharing different ones. Plus, I'm going to be sharing insights from Ian Welsh on when people and societies change. Also from Professor Henry Giroux, disposability in the age of disasters, from dreamers in Puerto Rico to violence in Las Vegas. Also from John Whitehead, Twilight of the American Courts. And also from Tom Dispatch, from Rebecca Gordon, When All the World's a War. And American Psychosis from Chris Hedges. Also, I'll be addressing some information, well, let's call it our mini little history lesson, about why they don't like us. I do not see any true objectivity from the mainstream media or even the alternative media on this. I'll share some insights in a history lesson to give you an idea why they probably don't like us. Let's begin. I want to start with a study from the University of British Columbia. Just think for a moment. Is it any wonder that most happiness idioms are associated with nature? Happy as a pig in muck, happy as a clam, happy camper. Well, a University of British Columbia researcher says there's truth to the idea that spending time outdoors is a direct line to happiness. In fact, if people simply take time to notice the nature around them, it'll increase their general happiness and well-being. The research published in a peer-reviewed journal examined the connection between taking a moment to look at something from the natural environment and personal well-being. And this study involved a two-week intervention where participants were asked to document how nature impacted them when they encountered it in their daily lives and how it made them feel. They took a photo of the item that caught their attention and jotted down a short note about their feelings in response to it. And other participants tracked their reactions to human-made objects. They took a photo and jotted down their feelings, and while a third group did neither. And then they analyzed it, and this is what he said, quote, "This wasn't about spending hours outdoors or going for long walks in the wilderness. This is about the tree at a bus stop in the middle of a city, and the positive effects that one tree can have on people." And the professor who did this, who studies wellness, says that she was, quote, overwhelmed not only by the response of her 395 study participants, more than 2,500 photos and descriptions of emotions were submitted, but also by the impact that simply noticing emotional responses to nearby nature had on personal well-being and their pro-social orientation, a willingness to share resources and the value they placed on community. Now, there is scientific documentation that people who live in green spaces generally seem to be happier, and they live longer than those who don't. And I think that's very important. Quote, "The difference in participants' well-being, their happiness, sense of elevation, and their level of connectedness to other people, not just nature, was significantly higher than participants in the group noticing how human-built objects made them feel in the control group." Frequently when I finish a show, in order to re-energize myself, because I get up early, 4 o'clock, I do a lot of research. And I write. I like to write commentaries. I take a break. When I'm in New York City, I generally walk through Riverside Park and just look at the river and just sit there. In that moment, it's not long, maybe half hour, I'm simply mindful of the entirety of the environment, just appreciating a tree or appreciating the breeze or looking across at the water or going over to Central Park and maybe going to the museum. I like to go up, look at the Frederick Church and Thomas Cole, the Hudson Valley artist, and just sitting there for 10 minutes, looking at the detail and just imagining what it would have been like to have been them before all the development on the Hudson River, where you could look for miles and it would be unobstructed. But sitting outside the museum, everywhere you go in Central Park, there's just pure beauty. And just being mindful of whatever's in front of you. That's what this is talking about. I just think that we need a lot more concept development of natural outdoor space, bring it indoors, so that all the future work environments should have that built in. So if you're going to have let's say you got a building and you're going to renovate it with green space inside, where you can create a natural water wall flowing into orchids, surrounding a pond with koi fish in the pond and water lilies. So in effect, someone taking a break, they can sit there and appreciate nature. It's just indoors, because the reality is most people don't get out enough, and especially in the shorter sunlight time in the winter when it frequently gets dark around 4 or 5 o'clock. So they're just getting off work. They may not have time to go out and appreciate nature. I just think we could do a lot more, and we should. So the more time you can spend in nature, the better it is for you. I had a person ask me, I hear you talk about quercetin, Q-U-E-R-C-E-T-I-N, and that you take it every day. Yes, I do. I take it about 5 times a day. Why do I recommend people take it? It does so much. It's one of the reasons that you're not going to look as old as you are chronologically, because as we begin to age, after the age of 27, really age, it's cumulative. Free radical damage, ultraviolet sunlight damage, getting too much sunlight, not protecting our body, or smoking, drinking, drugs. They all play havoc with oxidative stress, and that destroys your skin. How so? Because the skin itself does not wrinkle the way we think. The underlying musculature does, and that's why when people get Botox, which is paralyzing the muscle. By the way, just imagine what it's doing to your immune system every time you get Botox. Because every time you get Botox to smooth out your skin, you're not smoothing out the skin. You're simply paralyzing the underlying muscle that the skin lays on, so it's not then folding into those little crevices of the underlying musculature. But it means your entire body's immune system is put into a major crisis, having to go to that place and engulf all those microorganisms that the botulism or the Botox that is stuck into the skin. So the weaker your immune system, the longer the effects of Botox last, the stronger your immune system, the more frequent the injections, and the more frequent the injections, the more you tax your immune system. And sooner or later, you may end up having a serious infection or illness and not be able to recover quickly or at all because you've used Botox. I don't think most of the people tell you that. But what really holds up your skin to prevent that drooping, jowiness is collagen. And there are bands of collagen underneath the skin. And collagen needs certain nutrients, and two of the nutrients that really help keep it tight are vitamin C and quercetin. And vitamin C should be taken twice the dose of quercetin. So if you take 2,000 milligrams of vitamin C, you would take 1,000 milligrams of quercetin, and they should be taken at the same time because of the synergetic action. Also, if you bruise easily, if you have varicosities, if you have poor circulation, if you want to protect your heart from a heart attack, quercetin helps do that. But according to the University of Hawaii, as well as the University of Southern California, there's something else it does. And this was published in the American Journal of Epidemiology, the current issue. Now, we know that if you eat an apple, and you should each day, and you eat an onion, remember, an onion a day keeps a stroke away. An apple a day helps prevent premature aging. Well, quercetin, which is found in apples and onions, has been identified as one of the beneficial flavanols in preventing and reducing the risk of pancreatic cancer. And although the overall risk for reducing the amount of the study participants, smokers who consume foods rich in flavonoids, had a significantly greater risk of reduction. So just imagine you're taking in a nutrient, a flavanol, and that's a compound naturally found in plants, and it helps prevent the pancreatic cancer. So that's really very positive. They used 183,000 participants in this multi-ethnic cohort study for 8 years, and they wanted to check to see which food nutrients could impact it, and they found three flavanols, quercetin being the most easily to obtain. The other two are not so easily obtained. So that's good news. Get your apples. And there's two ways of getting your apples. So of course, there's three. Eat your apples. That's good. And now that you've got the crispies in, which are really good, you can skin the apple, put it in a blender, the four apple skins in a blender, and then juice the remaining apples, and then put that in juice into the blender as your liquefaction, and that gives you a phenomenal apple smoothie. Now, I also put lemon in there, and you can put blueberries in there and have yourself a phenomenal brain shake. That would be good for your brains. Skin of four apples, pint of blueberries, put 2 tablespoons of lemon juice in there, put the juicing of the apple juice in on top of it, blend it up, drink it down. From the University of Warwick, which is in the United Kingdom, as well as Sun Yat-sen University in China, they've done a study about cancer cells destroyed with a dinosaur extinction metal. Here's what's interesting. Cancer cells can be killed with metal from the asteroid that killed the dinosaurs, thanks to new research from the University of Warwick. It's a compound based upon iridium, and it kills cancer cells by filling them with deadly version of oxygen when activated by laser light without harming healthy tissue. And the researchers have, for the first time, discovered exactly which parts of the cancer cells are affected by treatment using highly advanced technology to analyze thousands of minuscule cell proteins. And cancer patients becoming increasingly resistant to traditional therapies, so it's vital to establish new pathways to fighting the disease. And cancer cells can be targeted and destroyed with a metal from the asteroid that caused the extinction of the dinosaurs. And so I think this is very important, very promising. I'll spell it for you, IRIDIUM. And it's an organic material which can be directly targeted towards the cells and transferring energy to the cells to turn the oxygen, or O2, inside them into singlet oxygen, which is poisonous and kills the cell, but it does not harm any healthy tissue. So that's terrific. And the process is triggered by shining visible laser light through the skin onto the cancerous areas. And this reaches the light-reactive coating of the compound and activates the metal to start filling the cancer cell with singlet oxygen. So that's good. I'm also keeping track of research being done in California, up near San Francisco, where they're using what they claim to be the original royal rife frequencies. And I've asked them to let me know when they're going to do clinical studies. I'd like to verify that. And because they're claiming at this moment they're able to completely reverse diabetic neuropathy in 4 to 5 days with about 20 minutes of light therapy per day, much rejuvenation to the spinal column. They're able to overcome lesions on the spine and different types of ulcers. So, and now they're working on the brain to see what they can do. when I see this clinical studies, and I'll say, good, you got it. But I think it's very promising because it's natural, non-toxic. University of Tennessee Health Science Center says that insomnia, not being able to get a good night's sleep, is going to cause you to die early. And you end up with kidney dysfunction. Now, we all know that insomnia is very detrimental. Anyone who's not been able to get a good night's sleep can tell you that. But chronic insomnia, where people wake up once, twice, three times a night, and they never get back to that deep, healing sleep, is highly prevalent in the world we live in. And we don't know all the impact, but we know that it's really bad. But the latest research shows it increased the risk of dying early and developing kidney problems. And so that's really not cool. So this was a six-year study, and that's where they came up with the results. So all that you can, so what's the solution? Well, the solution's several things. First, don't eat within 4 hours going to bed. If you are hungry, just have some cold water with lemon juice in it. Next, turn off all electromagnetic and unplug all electromagnetic field in your bedroom. Computer, unplug it. Television, unplug it. Just don't turn it off. If you turn it off, you won't see the screen, but the electromagnetic pulse is still there. Cell phones, turn them off. Take out the battery. Don't have digital alarm clock near your head. Then wear earplugs if you have problems with background noise, or a soft eye cover if you have problems with light. Then write down the problems you're trying to deal with that night, numbering. Here's what I want to deal with that's giving me problems. Write it down, like one line only, and that way it makes a big difference. Then you'll get a good night's sleep. Melatonin, also at 1 milligram, helps. Finally, Harvard Medical School says that a fiber-rich diet boosts the survival from cancer in the colon. So that's good news. Well, of course, what we know is that if you have a good diet to begin with lots of fiber, healthy fibers, you're far less likely to develop colorectal cancer. But in this study, among people treated with non-metastatic colon cancer, every 5 grams of fiber added to their diet reduced their odds of dying by 25%. Quote, what you eat after you've been diagnosed may make a difference. There is a possibility that increasing your intake of fiber may actually lower the rate of dying from colon cancer, maybe even other causes. So that's good news. I'm Gary Null. That's the latest on health and healing. Got a lot of commentary coming your way. Please stay with us.
Learn to play. Music ringing, burning in my ears. I had to pack my bag to get out of there. I went to New York, Chicago.
I'd like to welcome you. I'm Gary Null. I'm going to address one of our listeners out there. Questions that was raised. It's a good question. And made some comments. And then I'll just do it right now. It says, Gary, I believe the Green Revolution in India was sponsored by not the Rockefellers, but by the Ford Foundation. And while the reports of surveillance on artificial intelligence and IoT are utterly outrageous, deeply disturbing, and beyond a brave new world, it also requires massive compliance by billions of people. That's not so easy and has been foiled many times when you think of the plans the New World Orders had in mind for implementation by the year 2000. Just didn't happen. I think it's much more important that people remember their own power, and the plans of the 0.05% can get foiled in ways no one expected. As they say, man plans and God laughs. Even Truman in the Truman Show finally caught on and escaped. Mitchell J. Rabin And he is with a company that he does his own radio show, A Better World, a radio and TV. It's a good show. I like Ray Mitchell. He's been someone I've known for a long time. So let's address what you have had to say here, Mitchell. I'm going to be sharing some of my own thoughts as well as those of Ian Welch. First, let's assume for a moment that you're correct, that it's not just people in power deciding what they want politically, economically, globally, legislatively, judicially, but we have to agree to it at some level. We have to give them the right, our power, to implement these things. And after all, there are billions of us that are going to have to be converted for them to have this work. Well, let's just take a look. From 2000 till now, look at how much of the environment they have control over. Almost all. The power of legislation, virtually 100% of it. We have a president, we have a Senate, we have a House of Representatives, all representing the special interest groups, the 0.5%. The media. There are seven major media conglomerates that control 90% of all the media. Hence, the message they want to get out, they get out. And everyone on the internet who is a true progressive, Tom's Dispatch and Global Research, Truth Dig, RT, these are legitimate sources where the authors of articles and commentaries, they have something to say. All of these people at one time were members of the mainstream media, like Chris Hedges, and they decided they can no longer be a part of that because they would have had to have compromised their principles and integrity, honesty and decency and ethics. So they stepped out of that system. Well, so now those are being censored. They're called fake news. There's almost 100 organizations that you could go on the internet and you could find them. Now the algorithms are being controlled by Google and Facebook. They're not taking you to those sites anymore. In fact, some of those sites are being blocked. So they control even that one, they substantially control not all of it, but they control a lot of the traffic and where it goes on the internet. And now Hillary Clinton has a new foundation project where she or her group will start deciding what is legitimate news and what is not, and therefore attack those who are legitimate. The pro-vaccine movement has legions of people to attack anyone who is challenging the safety and efficacy of vaccines, even if you're like Robert F. Kennedy or Dr., let's say, Andrew Wakefield. He was destroyed. He lost his license to practice medicine, and yet he is pro to this day, pro-vaccine. I just saw a new documentary on him, and I was appalled. I was absolutely appalled because I thought, my God, man, why didn't you listen? And I went to bat for him. I did a seven-hour documentary special. It took me 6 months of investigating the charges against him to find out that they were all false. And then I debated his nemesis, Brian Deere, for an hour on Progressive Radio Network on his behalf. And yet he's still pro-vaccine. So, but even being pro-vaccine, which most of the people in the anti-vaccine movement are, they want simply a safer version of a vaccine, it doesn't mean that the people attacking them are going to let up on them at all. You have more character assassinations, more libel, more slander than ever before. Even Pacifica is loaded with people who are either agent provocateurs and have been implanted for a long time to make sure that nothing good ever happens at this foundation, but only it becomes a septic sore to liberal culture. It engages in libel, slander, and most importantly, as I mentioned recently, the second largest expense for years in the budget was paying off sexual predators, people who had harassed. And some are still employed, especially on some stations. I won't syndicate on those stations. That's how much contempt I have for that management and the culture of corruption and complicity that it engages in. So they have a lot of control. NPR, Wonder Bread for the Brain. So you got to take a look at that statement maybe again from a different perspective, because I haven't seen, maybe I missed it since 2000, maybe we've had marches against, let's say, poverty and the 16 million hungry children each day in America. Maybe we've had marches by these billions of people worldwide and millions in American cities and towns who lost their homes, 28 million total. Maybe we've had marches and protests to shut down the university systems until all student debt is forgiven and free public educational tuition systems are in place. Maybe we have, and you see where this is going, de-ghettoized American cities. Maybe we've protested our budget, 57% of every dollar going to the military-industrial complex to further perpetrate wars. And the trouble is, none of that has happened. It's one thing to think in a Pollyannish way and kind of like a, well, as long as we can go someplace and meditate and all do a kumbaya and throw out some positive energy, the world become a positive place. This is the kind of silliness that has perpetrated the entire illiterate, intellectual, pseudo-intellectual, and not even possibly intellectual communities in America. We can't even do yoga right. Unless I miss something, virtually all the studios in California and their ads, and look up on Facebook, you see these beautiful bodies, but all white, all young, all athletic, and teaching you about heat yoga. Well, that's nonsense. Any idiot could understand that. Or how about the beer yoga? Well, that's something really American. We have no concept of yoga. You're taking traditions that are hundreds of years old. And when was the last time you saw someone from India teaching true yoga or true meditation? We don't have time for meditation. We have to have it in quick. I'm going to my yoga meditation, then right after that I got to go. It's all done in microseconds. I've been there. I went to the number one yoga place in New York City. I filmed inside. It seemed serene and beautiful. And then I went outside and saw the people coming out, flipping on their cell phones and screaming at whoever was in their office. Something had to get done immediately. Well, what about that hour you just did in yoga? Oh, that was then. Now this is now. We have no foundational understanding of patience, discipline, mastery. And when you remove entirely the entire historical culture of yoga, and you don't see any people of color engaged in that, people from India engaged in it, but you've got the Americanization, which is meaning commodified. It's a $27 billion year industry. And the same thing for the whole nonsense, guttural spiritual movement that did not exist, never has existed, and can't exist in America. And yet people think they're spiritual because they did something, or what is the Grandmaster Reiki? Yeah, Grandmaster Reiki, you can't even pick your nose. So it's all fraud. In any case, but that's only one part of it. What is the more important part? It was Machiavelli who famously noted that men do not change. Ian Welsh agrees. I agree. Whatever they are, they're not going to change. What do I mean? I mean that whatever a person's normal personality, that's the way it's going to be for the rest of their lives. Fabius Maximus is the best example of that. Gentlemen who abhor violence rarely become violent when violence is necessary. Violent men who do not become peaceful when the times call for it, and so on. And look at the consequences of how many people come back from the conflict zones, serving in Vietnam or serving in Iraq, Afghanistan. They're coming back violent. That does not mean they went there violent. They had to be conditioned, programmed. They had to go through an intense indoctrination. There was no de-indoctrination. There's no scrubbing the conscious clean. What you've seen, what you've participated in, what you've allowed, or what you have witnessed will stay with you the rest of your life. Now you go become a cop, and you're frustrated. You've got extreme social anxiety disorder, and now you overact. Now you've got the bulletproof vest. You've got the guns. You're fully armed. You're big. You're on steroids. And you see someone who doesn't obey exactly what you want. Even if they do, it doesn't mean that you're going to restrain yourself. How's that happen? It's the conditioning, and that's where we're at. In our own times, we see that politicians raised under neoliberalism are unwilling and unable to effectively use Keynesian policies. They can't do stimulus when they try. They give the money primarily to the rich. They grew up to power by being neoliberals. Look at the Clintons, the best example of that. They have not had to suffer one day in their adult lives. So from the time he was Attorney General of Arkansas and she was with the Rose Law Firm, they have done nothing but support and enable neoliberals by the tens of thousands. Remember, with each administration, you get to choose anywhere around 1,400 to 2,000 people, and many of those are stay-behinds. Those are your people planted forever, and they've got your backs because you gave them their chance. So faced with new times, they cannot change. In fact, in France, we saw the main center-left party, really a neoliberal party, implode because it would just not change. And throughout the West, center-left, neoliberal parties are dying for just the same reason. The world has changed. The people who run these parties cannot change. Labor in Britain, they can be angry about something, but they're not going to change. Corbyn, who runs as a populist, he's not going to change. So this is as true of the large masses of people as it is individual leaders. And by the time men and women at 30 years of age, and often by their mid-20s, they are set. That's it. They have their personality. It is more or less work for them. There is world around them, and it's run in a certain way. And quite simply, they want to keep it running that way because it is the only world that they know how to navigate. This is true even if their lives are bad. They stagger on. A bad adaptation, what I call maladaptation, to the world is preferable to most people to a racial, radical environment, which if you're black and you suddenly have to adapt to the whites in your work environment or in your school environment or in your local social environment, how do you contend with that? Well, radical change in either themselves or the world is not going to happen. Most people, including most radicals, are innately conservative in the sense that once set, they don't like change. I remember looking back at how absolutely tyrannical was the coup. There was no counter-coup. It was only a one-sided ass-kicking when the people decided to privatize Democracy Now. And shame on the left for never doing your homework, never seeing what this was all about. But to this day, the people who were radicalized then are still radicalized today. They haven't changed, no matter what the evidence. The evidence is irrelevant. The truth is irrelevant. You will find more censorship on non-commercial Pacifica than any commercial radio station I've ever been on. I've been on all. ABC Network is their top nutritionist, and WABC, their number one show, until I chose after 12 years to leave. WR and WBD, all told 35 years, and WMCA, never once censored. On BAI, you're lucky not to go 6 months without being censored or taken off the air because some arbitrary decision by some jerk for some reason. And so where are you supposed to find the truth when people won't change? If you're mean to the bone, bad to the bone, bitchy to the bone, you're going to stay that way. You can move. You can change partners. But you're not changing. Intolerable means truly intolerable. When someone finally says, I can't take this anymore, then maybe you could change. Germany changed. Japan changed, at least to the degree that they had no choice after World War II, because they were left completely prostrate when they had lost everything. So when you've had your heart attack, you've had your stroke, and then finally you look at that fat body and your fat belly and you say, gee whiz, maybe I ought to stop rubbing my head, rubbing my belly, and talking Buddha talk and lose the weight, good. But what happens if the heart attack comes first? Then and only then will you hear someone, they call me and say, Gary, what do I do? What do you mean, what do you do? Well, I just had a heart attack. Yeah? What do you want, an award, a trophy? You took first place. In what? Well, you took first place and, you know, trying to kill yourself. You just didn't figure it would happen at this time, at this day, at this now. You want to change? I have no choice. But some people will go to their death with that notion of I'm not changing. So we live in a neoliberal world. We live where people talk about idealism, but there is no ideal in the current world. We talk about liberals, and there are no real liberals. The Bernie Sanders is not a liberal. Ask anyone in the Middle East. Ask anyone in foreign lands where he has supported military intervention. Ask them what they think of his liberalism. So that's the answer to that question. Oh, and by the way, Mitchell, on the issue of the whole idea of the Green Revolution was a disaster. I mean, it was an unmitigated disaster. Just read The New Scientist. New Scientist did a brilliant analysis, a detailed analysis, and on the revolution. And in fact, it was in April of 2017. It's called The Green Revolution Has Been an Utter Failure. It's by Charlie Merfield. And it talks about the 160 million children who are stunted because of malnutrition, the 600 million who are obese and they're nutrient deficient, the 793 million adults who are undernourished. Now, the only people who profited from the Green Revolution were the Rockefeller Foundation. It was the Rockefeller Foundation that sponsored that, not the Ford Foundation. And the Green Revolution's intention was to allow poor nations like India to overcome poor agricultural practices. But I don't consider their practices poor. In fact, if you went to a village, you might have 3,000 or 4,000 people all doing farming, small farming, and one or two or three items, and then sharing it at common markets. There was no malnutrition, and there was abundance all the time, unless you were in an extreme drought area. But in comes the wealthy people, and they buy up all that acreage, and they say, we're going to produce a lot more wheat. And indeed, they did. They had a genetic variety of wheat, so initially they had more wheat. But the Indian farmers didn't use pesticides, herbicides. They couldn't afford it. But the new people had to, because when you keep growing the same crop every year, you get insects. So now they had to despoil their soil, despoil the water under the soil in the aquifers. And now, instead of having hundreds of varieties of foods to eat, grown locally by the peasants, you had one crop, and that's it. And that was mainly for export. And that's what happened all over India. And it started in India in the 1960s, especially in Punjab and Haryana, and what is called the Uttar Pradesh. And the main development was higher-yielding varieties of wheat. And the methods adopted, including the high-yielding of seeds, and modern-day versions, be our GMOs, they used insecticides and herbicides and pesticides. They consolidated all the small little holdings into one giant holding. They powered through the land reforms, which took the people off the land. And they used sprinklers, not the old-fashioned drip system. So, in fact, at that time, 49% of all people in India were employed in agriculture. So it destroyed them. And it destroyed their way of life. It destroyed the way of sharing. It destroyed conservation of the land. It destroyed heirloom seeds. So everything was bad about the Green Revolution. And we can thank the racist Rockefellers for that. But I appreciate your input. Thank you very much. Now, I'm concerned about several things. And one is that Americans are developing a psychosis. Now, according to Chris Hedges, and Chris, by the way, I had on earlier this week, extremely articulate on these topics, all of our reality is under assault. I would agree with that. Verbal confusion reigns, and truth and illusion have emerged into one. I spoke about this yesterday, where literally in the near future, I'm talking about in the next year or two, they will be able to have, now that your cell phone, they can take these new cell phones and put a head monitoring system on them, and you can play virtual reality all you want. Well, if we're already addicted to the cell phone, it's just one more step to then sitting in a chair and lying back and tuning into whatever visualization you want. Well, now they're going beyond that to where they can actually take your thoughts and read them and then program your thoughts. Do you really want someone to program your thoughts? Now, you might say, yeah, but we're going to fight that. All to the contrary. You'll have more people lining up to get this than ever before because most people don't like their own thoughts. They're not smart enough to have their own thoughts. There's no sense of wonderment. There's no sense of anything because they've lived a completely passive existence. Everything has been given to them, coming into them. Oh, do I have to do homework? Oh, do I have to do math, algebra, calculus? Oh, that's too complicated. Why can't you just give me a trophy and say I passed my math class? My mom's very rich. My dad's very rich. One's a lawyer, one's a doctor, one's a CPA. Surely just take their money and say, I pass. Yeah, you pass what? You're functionally illiterate? So of course, if all you do is just sit there and absorb in when nothing is actually created by you, oh, what a wonderful way that'd be. Now, if the number one reason we go to the internet each day as a society is porn, and clearly something's wrong if you got to watch porn, when you're not having a fulfilling sex life. Because porn is voyeurism. And voyeurism means that you want to play it safe and have some projected fantasy of someone else doing something when you should be doing whatever you... If you had the imagination for it, find someone who's willing to share it with you. If you can't do that, now imagine the next step will be going from that headset that you wear to where they can put in there your sexual fantasies being fulfilled by the type of person you would want in your life. That's next up. That's already developed. Could you imagine then what's going to be happening to most people sitting around all day watching virtual reality, including their porn, and exactly how these people are supposed to function in society? They would not function. So mental chaos makes it hard to fathom what is happening. We feel trapped in a hall of mirrors. Exposed lies are answered with other lies. The rationale is countered with the irrational, cognitive dissonance prevails. We endure a disquieting shame and even guilt. Tens of millions of Americans, especially women and undocumented workers, Muslims and African Americans, suffer the acute anxiety of being pursued by a predator. And all this is by design. Demagogues always infect the governed with their own psychoses. Our new president, a 70-year-old orange-tinted, skinned-haired, strange person, almost, was it Penn Jillette who said that he looked like his hair was candy cotton or cotton candy? Trump often reminds us of his intellectual accomplishments. Really? And how smart your IQ is? You said it's one of the highest? Prove it. Show it. And oh, by the way, you said that your cabinet had by far the highest IQ in history? Prove it. It's all an absurdity avalanche. This mendacity would be easier to repulse if the problem were solely embodied in Trump. But even in the face of rising despotism, the Democratic Party, the little shank-shacked slime balls that they are, refuses to denounce the corporate forces that eviscerated our democracy and impoverished the country. The neoliberal Trump demonizes Muslims, undocumented workers, the media, and the neoliberal Democratic Party demonizes Vladimir Putin and the FBI director, and no one speaks about the destructive force of corporate power. You don't hear anyone in the media talking about their sponsors, do you? The warring elites pit alternative facts against alternative facts, all engaged in demagoguery. We will, I expect, be condemned to despotism by the finality of Trump and the cowardice and dishonesty of the liberal class. Trump and those around him have a deep hatred for what they cannot understand, and they rarely understand anything. They clearly have not understood why, quote, they hate us. If they did understand, then they would have seen that it's what we've done. I don't have time today, but on my next show, I'll give you a history lesson on what they've done, which is a very good reason why we should be concerned, but not the people in power. They silence anyone who thinks independently. They elevate pseudo-intellectuals, which is all that I've ever seen in the media, who adhere to their bizarre script. Even William F. Buckley, that suck-up punk that used to be such a darling of the liberal of the conservative community because his quality vocabulary, absolutely, I give him high marks for that, but not in the context of anything representing a humanistic or a worldview. So these people cannot cope with complexity, nuance, and unpredictable stance. Individual initiative is a mortal threat. The order of some employees of several federal agencies, including the Environmental Protection Agency and the U.S. Agricultural Services, the National Parks and Defense, Health and Human Services, are all restricted. They must now cease communication with the press or members of Congress, along with the attempt to impose 10-year felony convictions on six reporters who covered the inauguration protest. That, ladies and gentlemen, signals the beginning of a campaign to marginalize reality and promote fantasy. Facts depend solely on those who have the power to create them. The goal of the Trump administration is to create an artificial consistency that conforms to a warped perception of the world. And that is the only power today that you see outside of the small margins where the rest of us coexist. Back in a moment. Please stay with us. Well, for the last 8 weeks, I have been, four of those weeks, at a health retreat to try to help a small group of people through major changes with major diseases or illnesses that medicine had no way of countering or reversing, let alone slowing down. And we've had major progress. All those people are being given their new examinations by the original doctors or hospitals this week and next week. I will then have them on to personally so you can see what the progress has been. Because we're talking about end-stage cancer and advanced multiple sclerosis and advanced dementia and Alzheimer's. But before then, it was 2 weeks of dealing with post-hurricane, still dealing with that every day. Even today, woke up, no electricity, no power. That's a consequence. So I haven't had an opportunity to offer any of our audience in over 8 weeks any special. Apologize for that, but today I'm going to make it up to you. So listen carefully. I'm going to give you a special I've never given, ever. So you're going to want to take advantage of this. It involves three products. One is digestive stuff, one is sleep stuff, and one is cardio stuff. And if you get a combination of these, first you're going to get a big, steep discount on each of these three. You can get any one or two or three, but if you get two of these, or coming to $150, I'm going to give you free a $113 bottle of women's stuff. That's the special blend I made with dong quai and maca and nettle root and wild yam and ashwagandha and flaxseed and isoflavones and sweet potatoes and blueberries and kale and cacao and broccoli and apples and bananas and oat brown. And it's just one phenomenal product. That's $113. You get that free if you order two of the other products. And also you're getting a free DVD in there as well on women's health. So let's take them real quick. What is digestive stuff? Well, from my experience, people are not eating right. They're eating too fast. They're overeating. They're not eating good combinations of food. They're eating too acidic. And they're rushing. They're under stress when they eat, all of which impacts their digestion. And that's not good because you really have to understand that health starts in the intestine. That's my personal opinion, as well as others who have been in the field for a long period of time. So I want to give you something that makes a difference. So in here I put my own blend, a passion flower, and valerian extract, and chamomile extract, and ashwagandha extract, and melatonin, and theanine, and hops, and reishi mushrooms. And these are really very, very important that you... I was talking about digestive stuff. In digestive stuff, it's different. It's papaya, pineapple, apple, banana, bromelain, amylase, lipase, these are enzymes, protease, which helps you break down protein, cellulase, ginger, cinnamon, anise, fennel, whole leaf aloe vera, marshmallow root, slippery elm bark, and two types of probiotics, B. longum and L. acidophilus, 12 billion, that's 12 billion probiotics plus pineapple, and that's in digestive stuff. So you take this right after a meal, your major meal, you take one scoop. That's digestive stuff. And I don't know of anything better anywhere than that when it comes to digestion. Now, for those of you who have trouble sleeping, and a lot of people do, you take this one scoop 2 hours before you go to bed. And this has the passion flower extract, valerian extract, chamomile extract, ashwagandha extract, melatonin, L-theanine, hops, reishi mushroom, lipase, amylase, protease, inulin, jasmine, tea, and GABA, magnesium citrate, lemon balm, skullcap, catnip. Well, that's just as good as it gets when it comes to the best thing for sleep. And of course, the big one is cardio stuff. Now, I can't tell you how important it is not to pay attention to your cardio system. So what have I done? I've created what I consider, at least from my perspective, if someone else can do it better, good for them. But cardio stuff is my own proprietary blend of organic oatmeal and brown rice bran and oat bran and red wine extract and flaxseed, cold press, and sunflower, lecithin, and papaya, blackberries, bananas, hawthorn berries, grapeseed extract, ginkgo biloba, panax ginseng, cayenne, apple, cacao, green tea, decaffeinated, blueberries, pomegranates, almonds, vitamin C, turmeric extract, which is your curcumin, vitamin E, reishi mushrooms, coenzyme Q10, quercetin, resveratrol, and magnesium citrate, potassium citrate, and organic inulin. So there's the three formulas: cardio stuff, sleep stuff, and digestive stuff, and they're all on sale. Big discounts, huge discounts. But if you get any two of those, you also get free a $113 bottle of women's stuff. And if you're a man, buy it for the women in your life. If you're a woman, buy it for yourself. And you get that free, plus you get a $40 DVD that was on used on PBS stations on the new Healthy Woman. So that's like $153 gift in the value of those two products. So what do you do? I'm going to give you a number to call. And this is only as good as product last. Call 877-627-5065. 877-627-5065. Again, 877-627-5065. And I'm giving you a huge discount. In effect, I'm giving you a huge discount by itself, but then I'm giving you this extra free that you can use or give as a gift. And this is as good as it can get for a lot of women's input at a nutritional level. And that's because I haven't done this in 8 weeks. So order one, two, or three. If you order any two, you get that women's for free. But that's our special for now. 877-627-5065. Giovanni, Sandy, Mila, Diane, they're all standing by to take your calls. We're going to conclude today's program with a look at something that needs some attention. That is National Public Radio. National Public Radio, I believe, should be very responsible in having a wide variety of progressive guests on, especially since so often they have guests that represent a particular ideology. And we're never questioning their sponsorship. We should. Lee Camp did, and here is Lee Camp questioning NPR.
NPR, National Public Radio, the liberal bastion of American media. I used to think it was. I came up listening to it. It's got a lot of lovely shows. This American Life, where you learn about the life of the Americans. But it actually has a lot of influence and influences on what they report and why they report it. From NPR's own website, they say, all NPR funding sources, including corporate sponsors, are considered under the access principle, which means that NPR has no list of sources from which funding will not be accepted. However, potential conflict of interest and problems of listener misperception, confusion, or similar reason regarding the funder's role and or influence on programming will be considered in accepting or rejecting underwriting. Ah, yes, no funding sources will be refused. Let's go through some of these corporate sponsors, shall we? Aetna, pushing their healthcare agenda, which is really profiting off of the sickness and death of your average citizens. ENGA, America's Natural Gas Alliance, which is a nice way of saying the natural gas lobby. ENGA was acquired by the American Petroleum Institute in 2015. Do you really think we're going to hear about the stranglehold that that industry has on our politicians? If NPR accepts underwriting funds from ENGA, we're probably not going to hear about the harms of fracking. Fracking wells have led to the evacuation of whole communities. It's led to groundwater contamination. Water's on fire. And NPR interviews often don't follow up on the claims of fracking reps. One interview said, you know, fracking is misunderstood. This country is so much better off with the shale boom. The amount of jobs, the amount of economic revenue, the security for our country. Oh yeah, you can only make jobs just destroying communities. There could never be jobs planting trees, cleaning water. There's no job putting in solar panels. It's only in fracking and oil and gas. On top of that, the data actually shows that fracking has created very few jobs. The few jobs that have been created are actually outsourced to existing oil and gas employees. However, fracking has created one thing in communities that is definitely, it's not a lie, it's definitely the truth. Gonorrhea. No, literally, all the fracking men come to town and then they create a plague of STDs. More corporate sponsors. I know you want to hear more corporate sponsors. Apple, of course, CBS, CNN, Exxon, Ford, Fidelity, GE, Goldman Sachs nearly brought down the world economy, and now they continue to run the White House. So you can put whoever you want in the White House. It's still run by goddamn bankers. Microsoft, NBC Universal, the Pharmaceutical Research and Manufacturers of America. You know what? I met some of them, and they just offered me some lovely opioids. Which, you know, since I come from a collapsing mining town, I thought this is a good time to try these out. Literally, they push these things on struggling communities, which is why America has an opioid crisis. Turner Broadcasting, Wells Fargo, Whole Foods, and the Weinstein Company. Now, the Weinstein Company, that didn't really fit on the list because, you know, they're quite good and they haven't had any controversial moments in the, you know, past several years. So, I felt I should include... What's that? Oh, God. But when trying to get these corporations to become sponsors, they actually say on their websites, NPR has the halo effect, which is the positive association and shared values that NPR listeners attribute to the companies that sponsor us. Basically, they're saying, we take money from anyone, no matter how horrific you are, and you will then have a halo around your corporate brand. You will then be known as having good values, whether you do or not. Exxon's here. Our Lord and Savior, Fidelity Banking. NPR was part of the establishment machine that maligned and tore apart and smeared Edward Snowden back when he revealed that we live under the largest surveillance state ever created. Big data firm says it can link Snowden data to changed terrorist behavior. The article was based on a report by Recorded Future. The company, Recorded Future, brought in a cyber expert, the CEO of Reversing Labs. The CIA's venture funding arm is InQtel. Well, InQtel is an investor in Recorded Future. InQtel has a strategic partnership with reversing labs. After NPR got backlash for not revealing that they were quoting companies with ties to the CIA, the reporter responded, "I just forgot to include that." Ah, did ya? In pretty much all of their reporting on the war on terror, they've rarely, if ever, mentioned that the CIA trained thousands of Islamic extremists in the 1980s. They did this to defeat the Russians in Afghanistan. Ah, where did all these well-trained, well-funded extremists come from? But NPR acts like Al-Qaeda just popped up out of nowhere. They helped sell the war in Iraq. They helped sell the bombing in Syria. They helped sell the endless campaign in Afghanistan. They've had biased coverage on Iran, often not giving the full context. The fact that our military bases basically surround Iran. Iran hasn't invaded anyone in a long time, whereas the U.S., kinda constantly. They seem to fail to mention that Israel has nuclear weapons. That is now, even though the American government tried to hide that fact for years, it has now come out in FOIA requested documents. I mean, it was kind of an open secret, but not on NPR. It was a secret on NPR. And then there's Syria. NPR actually brags about Syria. We've had 305 stories aired in 2016. How many of them mention that one of the reasons we're likely in Syria is because they said no to an oil pipeline? How many of those reports actually mention that at least at times CIA-backed and funded rebels were fighting Pentagon-backed and funded rebels? So NPR ultimately acts like a public relations arm for the entities that it's funded by. They're traditionally pro-capitalism. They're traditionally also, of course, pro-Wall Street. They say positive things most of the time, a large percentage of the time, about the big banks, about banks in general, about investment firms. I kept expecting during Occupy to hear some good reporting on NPR, but then I found that, first of all, they ignored it. Then when they did cover it, it was like, oh, they don't know what they're doing down there. Who knows what they're upset about? Maybe the fact that all the wealth of the nation has been sucked to a phenomenally
okay. Just some thoughts about NPR. There are some very good shows on NPR, well-produced, informative, and objective. And then there's a lot of mindlessness. But behind all of it, corporate sponsorship. And that's unfortunate. I'm Gary Null. Thank you all for listening. Have a nice day.